something about albumin as a drug carrier and about 15 years of research of getting a drug into the clinic. I'm going to take you back in time. 1986, a young Japanese scientist does an interesting experiment. He injects dye, Evans blue, into a tumor-bearing mouse, into a sarcoma-bearing mouse, at this dose of 10 milligrams per kilogram. And to his surprise, he finds that the tumor is stained already after 6 hours. Now, what was the reason for that uptake? Was there an affinity for the dye, for the tumor? Was there a ROCK receptor involved? The reason was somewhat different. The reason was that once you injected this dye, it would bind very rapidly to albumin, and albumin would transport the dye to the tumor. And this was the man who did this experiment, who is, of course, now much older, Hiroshi Maeda. Some of you will know him because he is coined the expression enhanced permeation and retention of macromolecules in relation to tumor targeting. And he published this in 1986, and when you look at the graph down here, you can see basically these are the levels of the Evans blue albumin complex. This is the uptake in the tumor over time, and as a comparison, you can see there is no uptake in the muscle. This experiment is very reproducible, so when you do it in your own lab, this was probably done something like 8 years ago. It's a very intense dye which you inject in a mouse, and when you then pull the blood and you centrifuge it, you can see that the color goes down as it goes down here, and the 86 micromolar he found here after 1 hour corresponds exactly to that value. The affinity for Evans blue for albumin can be shown very simply with this experiment on a geofiltration column. So you're seeing Evans blue here. This is Evans blue plus pre-incubated albumin, so as it binds, it then elutes down the column. The same happens with plasma and blood. It doesn't happen with transferrin or apotransferrin or any immunoglobulin. If you do the full experiment, so you perform this experiment in tumor-bearing mice, this is the staining you get. This is our own experiment done in a pancreatic xenograft model. And if you then, after different time points, look how much Evans blue has gone to the organs and the tumors, this is the picture you get. This is after 6 hours. You can see all organs are still very blue because Evans blue, of course, is still hanging on to albumin. So you have to perfuse the mouse for at least 3 minutes with the sodium chloride, and that's when you can actually analyze how much Evans blue has gone to the organs. And if you then look at how those organs look, this is what you see after 6 hours, 24 hours, and 48 hours. And you can already see the liver, the kidneys, they don't really have a blue staining, but there's a blue staining with the subcutaneous growing tumors. And that color intensifies with time. When you do an extraction of those tumors, this is what you get. You can see over 1 hour, 160 hours, there's a maximum at 24, 48 hours, where most of the Evans blue albumin complex has accumulated in the tumor. So that's a very nice and very simple experiment to show that albumin accumulates in solid tumors. There are other experiments which were published around the same time. This is an experiment learned from Hans-Jörg Sinn at the German Cancer Center. He used radio-labeled albumin. This is a rat model, and this rat bears a sarcoma in its hind leg, and he radio-labeled albumin, injected it into the rat, and you can see up to 23% of the injected amount of albumin is accumulated after 72 hours in this tumor. In the heart, a lot of albumin is still circulating, and this is what the surroundings of the liver, what you're seeing here. So there was a lot of evidence at that time, which was really not taken very seriously at that time, because antibodies were coming up and people thought antibodies would make the race. Albumin is a interesting protein in the sense that it is already a pharmaceutical. It's used for as a blood substitute to treat severe burns, for cachexia in tumor patients. It's a blockbuster, $1.3 billion sales per year. It's the most abundant protein, 40 grams per liter. So we have 200 grams of liter in our blood, and another 200 grams in our extracellular part of the body. So really about half a kilo of that protein in our body. And you can see by far, compared to other proteins in the bloodstream, it is the most abundant one. Now, at the end of 1999, there were basically two groups who were interested in albumin as a drug carrier. One was Neil Desai, who developed Abraxane, and one was the group I led in Freiburg, which developed another technology of using albumin. And the difference is really, how is the drug attached to albumin? Neil Desai used lipophilic drugs and physically bound his drugs to albumin, and we used a prodrug technology which would covalently bind the drug to the surface of albumin. I'm going to present you the technology of Abraxane first, and then focus most of my talk on the drug we developed and which is now in registrational phase 3 trial from Citrix. This is Abraxane. It's a nanoparticle, so it's a very easy technology. You use paclitaxel and you mix it with albumin, and under high pressure it's passed through a jet, and then these nanoparticles are formed with a diameter of around 130 nanometer, and that's what you have in the vial. So the nanoparticle is a formulation. It is not a carrier. Once you inject that into the bloodstream, these nanoparticles disperse very rapidly, and what is actually being transported around the body are particles which look like that. You have the lipophilic paclitaxel absorbed to different parts of albumin, and that's how it is transported into the tumor. The advantage, of course, it avoids ethanol and cremophore, which can be a pain when you treat that in patients, because it can cause serious anaphylactic shocks in some cases. It's not common, but when it occurs, it can be deadly. This drug was already taken 2005 in a head-to-head trial in breast metastatic cancer and proved to have an advantage in response and an overall survival benefit of around 2 months. And that was confirmed later in combination trials with carboplatin and gemcitabine in pancreatic cancer and non-small cell lung cancer, and is meanwhile a blockbuster product. It used to be with Abraxis Oncology, it is now with Celgene. The other technology is the one we developed, and the idea was that we wanted to have a more fine-tuned release of the drug, and for that we developed prodrugs, and we developed the prodrugs that they would not be formed outside of the body, but as you inject them. So it's a small molecule approach shown here. You build up a prodrug consisting of a protein binding group, a linker, and the drug. This is injected directly into the body, and it then binds to a very specific amino acid on albumin, cysteine 34. You then, out of a small molecule, you make a macromolecule conjugate. This circulates with all the advantages of carrying a drug to the tumor, and then either by an acid-promoted release or an enzymatic release, you accumulate the drug in the tumor and the tumor cells to have a better therapeutic index. And this is then, after some fine-tuning and modeling, the drug which emerged as the best candidate. We already by that time had a lot of experience with doxorubicin, a drug which is widely used in cancer chemotherapy. It's approved for 10 indications. It's a nice red powder, so you can do chemistry with it and follow it quite easily. You can do fluorescence microscopy and so on. And this is what the drug looks like. This is doxorubicin, which has a keto group here. And we introduce this linker here, a hydrazone bond, which is acid sensitive, and a malamide group, which is a thiol reactive group. We could show that once you inject that into the bloodstream, it binds rapidly within less than a minute to the cysteine 34 position of endogenous albumin. And we have meanwhile in 10 mouse bottles shown that it is definitely superior to doxorubicin, the clinical standard. In 50% of these models, we obtain complete remissions in comparison to doxorubicin. I've already shown you the formulation here, how it is applied in all clinical studies. Basically, it's a lyophilized powder which is reconstituted in the clinical pharmacy, and then it's diluted with lactated ringer solution, and it's infused over 30 minutes to the patient. This cysteine 34 is a novelty for a circulating protein, because when you measure the cysteine thiol concentration in blood, you measure around 500 micromolar, and 90% of that thiol concentration is due to this cysteine 34 of albumin. So that's why you get a very selective and specific binding to this position. If you do some modeling with an X-ray structure of human serum albumin, you see how snugly this linker fits into the cavity. The cavity of cysteine 34 is about 10 to 12 angstrom deep. This is cysteine 34, this is the linker. And you can see doxorubicin now on the surface of albumin. And in fact, when you do the modeling, hydrogen bonds stabilize doxorubicin on the surface, and that's why it's a very stable formulation as it circulates in the bloodstream, which is, of course, a prerequisite. We don't want to lose too much of the drug, or any drug at all, before it reaches the tumor. But this hydrazone bond here is a very sensitive hydrazone bond. So in the blood, you have pH 7. In the tumor, you have, when it goes into the endosomes, pH 5 or even 4, and then it's released within 25 minutes. And that's doxorubicin, you're releasing the original drug. So the mode of action looks basically like this. Once you reach the tumor, the albumin conjugate, which is formed, is taken up by adsorptive endocytosis. taken up in endosomes or lysosomes where the pH goes down, you cleave the drug and doxorubicin enters the cell. There can also be some release outside of the cell because it is known that the extracellular environment of tumors can be acidic. If you measure it in humans, for example, with pH electrodes, it's between 6 and 6.8. This is what a typical mouse model comparing doxorubicin and L-doxorubicin looks like. We knew from the experiments we had done for the MTD study that we could dose this drug, this prodrug, L-doxorubicin, at higher doses. So this dose always refers to doxorubicin equivalents. This is the standard dose for doxorubicin in xenograft models. This is a mouse breast cancer model. This is the relative tumor volume. So you can see that in these 30 days, the tumor has increased by a factor of around 4. With doxorubicin, there is some effect. But with the dose of L-dox at the same toxicity, you're getting complete remission. So I'm going to skip all of the toxicology experiments you have to do under GLP and all of the GMP manufacturing we did, and move straight away to the clinical assessment of this drug. L-doxorubicin positioning, it's the best class in anthracyclines if you compare it to epirubicin or other anthracyclines. An advantage of L-dox, and we've treated over 500 patients so far, we've seen no sign of acute cardiotoxicity, which of course is a rare but very serious side effect of doxorubicin. We can dose more in man, so there was a exact translation from mice, dogs, and rats to humans. We could transfer that MTD shift of 3.5 to 4.5 to humans. The doses are shown here. And we have less side effects. For instance, we see basically no alopecia, which is the main side effect of doxorubicin. We can also dose more frequently. And if we dose lower than the 260, for instance, at 170, we basically have no side effects at all. These are the clinical trials which have been ongoing for several years now. So we Cytrex decided to take a mixture of in phase one, phase two, and phase three trials. This is also all on our homepage, so I'm only going to concentrate today on sarcoma. We did a first-line soft tissue sarcoma study and an overlapping second line soft tissue sarcoma, and these are the ones I'm going to present today. Why soft tissue sarcoma? Sarcomas are very difficult to treat. They have an extremely bad prognosis. They're not carcinomas, which of course are the majority of all cancers, and they affect muscle, fat, blood vessels, nerves, tendons, and they can appear basically anywhere in the body. Most appear in the arms and legs. They can appear in the gastrointestinal tract or in the head and neck. It's an orphan drug disease, so we have about 40,000 new cases in the US. Per year, about 150,000 new cases. The standard of care at the moment is doxorubicin and ifosfamide. These are the two drugs which clinicians will give. And for us, that was a good comparator to take into a trial where we wanted to see if we were better than this drug, which of course has been around for over 30 years. So that's why we did a first line and a second line head-to-head trial versus this drug. This data has been reported. This is the setup of the first line phase 2 trial design. We screened 140, 123 were randomized, half of the group entered L-DOX on 260 milligrams per square meter DOX equivalents given every 3 weeks, and DOXO at the curative dose of 75. And CT scans were performed every 6 weeks. When we then got the data for progression-free survival, this is what it looked like. We had a clear advantage for L-DOX. This is the scans read by investigators, and you must, because it's an orphan drug disease, it's a multi-trial investigation. Over 50 centers took part in this trial. We had a benefit of nearly 4 months in progression-free survival, statistically significant. What is important, investigators are sometimes biased, especially if you do it in many centers. So you hand out the scans to a central lab in the US, which don't know which drugs were administered, and then they make a readout. And mostly that data in all trials, if people make the bother to do it, because of course you have to pay for this, they don't score as good as the investigator trials. So we have a 3 months benefit compared to a 3.7 months benefit, but that's still good for a drug compared to the clinical standard, doxorubicin. And what is important, what I've learned, and when you're young, you're very ambitious and you say, well, I'm going to develop a drug to cure cancer. And when we talk about sarcoma, these are metastasized sarcoma patients, so these are late stage patients. And you actually have to rid yourself of the idea that you are going to do everything positive for every patient which is entering a trial. And these waterfall plots show basically how the picture looks like. So this is L-doxorubicin. These are the 83 patients in that first trial. And you see the response rate. So this is basically no response rate. This is stable disease, zeros. There's no change in the therapy. And this is where 30%, over 30% reduction in the overall tumor burden, that includes all metastasis. If that is over 30%, it's named an objective response, a partial remission. If you go to 100%, it's a complete remission. And you can see now that these are the patients which really profited from the therapy. These patients did not profit from the therapy. If you look, so when you see a number, which you often see in the literature, the overall survival is 2 months, you can say, well, why are the patients doing this? They're metastasized, they're probably not in a very good state. The reason is because they have this chance. And these patients live over 2 years. They get back their mobility, and unfortunately, these don't. And so you get an average value, which is reported, and that's mostly what the FDA looks at, which I don't think always is the correct way of analyzing data, because we have to realize a drug is never a miracle. It's the best we can do to improve the quality of life and maybe restore for as long as time possible the people's health and getting them back to work and getting them back to activity. Now, this wasn't a trial for getting approval, because we had already started a second-line trial. And why had we done that in second-line sarcoma, which had failed first-line therapy? The rationale for doing that is because the response rate for sarcoma, as you saw, is so low. With doxorubicin, it's 0 to 15% in the literature. So these patients, after two administrations, move immediately to a second-line situation. And in second line, there is no standard of care. So that's why we went into this very large study done in even more centers. I'll go to that in a minute. We had a special protocol assessment by the FDA, which allowed us to dose until progression, because our drug was tolerated very well, and there was no reason to stop after six cycles, sort of the traditional thing you do, if the patient was responding and had no side effects, which were preventing any further treatment. 400 patients were included, 200 in one arm getting Aldox, and they had then a choice of five drugs which they could choose from, which I'll show you in the minute. The endpoints were progression-free survival, that is the primary endpoint which correlates with response, and the secondary is overall survival, which actually for approval does not play a role for this serious sarcoma. The setup looks like this. 400 patients were randomized in, we started on the 1st of February in 2014. 200 got Aldox every 3 weeks until disease progression, and the other 200 patients, the physician had a choice between doxorubicin if they had no prior doxorubicin treatment, dacarbazine, ofosfamide, gemcitabine, or a kinase inhibitor. Now this trial has enrolled in 76 sites in 9 countries. The enrollment was finished in November of last year. We are actually blinded to this study. That's a choice you can make with the FDA. So we only know when things like every patient has been enrolled, but we don't know how the patients are doing. And the rationale for that is if you are not biased, so you get weekly reports and you get a good result, which we'll get in the summer of this year, that's why I put this in red. If we have good results, we definitely have not biased this study. We have not influenced doctors anywhere to say, well, why don't you take that patient or that patient, and then you get a quicker approval. That's the reason why you blind it. Although, of course, it does make it nerve-wracking because you have to wait for 2 years whether you're going to get approval. And so in June, July, we will have that data, and it comes out because we are at NASDAQ and we have to report this data. We're actually obliged to do it. So you can still invest in Cytrix. And as you know, the Americans are optimistic, so we're already planning our launch for 2017. But we'll have to see as the data comes in, and we have the final data. I want to finish with two words and two slides. We have since 2 years established a drug discovery branch in Freiburg, which I head, developing pipeline products using this technology, but using linker technology in general. So we work on new linkers, we work on drugs, and we work on different protein binding groups to expand this technology. We also work on different carriers like antibodies. In my next talk at some time, I will be able to talk more about which pipeline products we have developed and which will have a chance to go into the clinic. Drug delivery. Why have I done this for 20 years in cancer? It's because I think it's when you look at chemotherapy and even protein kinase inhibitors, what is lacking is really any kind of accumulation in the tumor. Once you infuse a drug, very, very little of the drug goes into the tumor, and you lose most of it in your healthy organs. So this is a diagram showing a typical growth of a tumor over time. So this is 1 billion cells where you can actually detect a tumor where it has a size of 1 cubic centimeters. And this is where you, if you're lucky and you can detect it, you actually start treatment, whether it's chemotherapy, a mixture now of kinase inhibitors and antibodies. And if you're lucky, you can then see a response. And you do your cycles. In the best cases, you're in the curative setting. This only happens in about 10 to 20% of cases, assuming this has not metastasized. In the symptoms you have when you are at an advanced stage, you really are in a palliative treatment, and because the patients don't tolerate too much of drugs, they mostly, if you're lucky, get a slight stable disease, but mostly then you have to stop treatment. So curative, 10 to 20%, palliative, 80 to 90%. And of course, if you take it from a financial aspect, the pharma companies make their money here, they don't make it here. Last words. So it's very, from my experience, easy to treat mice who have tumors because the doubling time is much faster. They have a doubling time of something like 3 to 4 days. That's a typical range you have. In humans, the doubling time can be between 5 and 200 days. Prostate cancer, typical example. It grows very sluggishly, and sometimes for years nothing happens. So there's really no need for therapy. And of course that's been a dilemma for a long time, what one should do in cases like that. But I think for at least the palliative situation, we will get improvements with the different drug delivery technologies which are emerging, that you can add this to the existing therapies with which we treat cancer. Thank you very much for your attention, and looking forward to further talks.
Thank you. Thank you very much. One or two questions?
Thank you for this very interesting talk. I was hoping for a more optimistic end, but unfortunately. I was wondering, in your comparisons to doxorubicin, did you also compare to the Doxil liposomal delivery system?
We have in trials and orientating trials, we have had patients who have been treated with Doxil and have then moved on to L-Dox. These were phase 1B studies, and which have responded, yes. But the patients here in the phase 3 registrational trial, they can have received Doxil, mm-hmm. and then they are eligible to enter into the trial with L-Dox. Mm-hmm. So we will have the comparison of patients who have treated with any anthracyclines, whether Doxil or epirubicin, whether L-Dox still can do something. We will have that data.